Hey guys, this is Modine here. It's Sunday night on my birthday, November 26th. So I'm going to say happy birthday to myself and greet you guys too. First off, thanks for watching. Anyway, everyone's asleep now, so I'm in my little study room and just wanted to see if I can answer some questions with explaining a few things and maybe even drawing up a little bit of a schematic, just freehand, right off the bat. Answer your question. Some of the 12 dB per octave Linguist Rally crossovers. There's a lot of calculators online, but this is probably one of my favorite websites that I've used for the past few years. Here is the URL. It's called mh-audio.nl, and the author of the page is a pretty well-known sound guy, music guy, so he's got a lot of calculators. So if you click on calculators here, right up here, you come over and it comes up with all these online calculators, all the way from loudspeaker stuff to crossover networks, and you have all kinds of stuff like sealed enclosure calculator, vented box, transmission line. There's even a passive radiator, one down at the bottom. But to answer your direct question, there is one called calculate 6, 12, 18, and 24 dB crossover filters. And if you go all the way down, scroll down, they give some descriptions of basic descriptions of what a 6, 12, 18 or first, second, third, and fourth order crossovers are, advantages of each one. Just keep going down, and there's actually a Linguist Rally crossover. And there's, of course, the author also explains the advantages and disadvantages of each one. If you go all the way to about the brief explanation part here, Linguist Rally is a pretty good one here. And going all the way to the bottom, here it is right here. So here's a schematic right here. You can simply plug in your known tweeter and woofer impedance values. For example, I'm using a tweeter impedance Dayton Audio. It's 3/4 inch silk dome tweeter. At least it's 6 ohms. Type in 6 ohms right there, and then the woofer or the mid-range is roughly about 4 ohms, and let's say I want to have a crossover frequency of 6500 hertz. Type that in there, and then you get a capacitor inductor value for the high pass and then also for the low pass. So that's how I did the last 3 or 4 builds, with the same values of capacitors and inductors. And all you have to do is follow this instruction here. C1 is capacitor 1, inductor 1, and then C2, L2. And then this is how you would wire it up. So basically, this is, let me see, where is it? Right here. This would be for the woofer. So basically, your low frequencies would be shunted across the capacitor, and the low frequencies are allowed to pass through the inductor towards the woofer. And then over on the high pass, the inductor shunts the low frequencies, and then the capacitor allows high frequencies to go through the tweeter. So basically, anything above 6500 hertz goes to the tweeter, and there is a pretty steep drop off at 12 dB per octave for anything lower than 6500 hertz, and then anything above 6500 hertz. This is the high pass filter, so it only allows anything above 6500 hertz to play with the tweeter. It keeps it safe, and higher frequencies don't require as much power either, compared to especially lower frequencies. On low pass, this setup here basically allows you to play all the lower frequencies without having any high frequencies played through the woofer there. Lower frequencies tend to require more power for the same sound pressure level. I'm going to draw a real quick diagram the way I've hooked it up. I have to forgive the note and pad. Okay, so basically, you have your amplifier here. You have a right channel and left channel, negative, positive, negative, positive. So I'm just going to draw it for one channel. The same thing is going to be the same thing on the other channel. So for example, if I have a small little tweeter here, and then I have a larger woofer, negative, positive, negative, positive. So these are essentially going to be in parallel. So with the tweeter, I'm going to have an inductor that's going to shunt the low frequencies, and then a capacitor that will pass. So this is going to go all the way to negative, and this will go all the way to positive. So this is the tweeter, and this is the woofer over here. In this case here, we have a capacitor that's going to shunt all lower frequencies, and then an inductor to allow everything to come through low frequencies only. So this will be negative here. So this will go eventually all the way over, around, and then in parallel. You can connect it anywhere pretty much. With the positive, same thing. Go directly to the positive right here. So this is 6 ohms, and this is 4 ohms. If you do the DC math, it's probably going to be something less than 4, but remember this is AC actually. So these are frequencies all the way from, let's say, default 20 hertz to 20,000 hertz. Based on these values of the tweeter and the woofer, you're going to have this impedance. This impedance is essentially going to be resistance, but it's going to be as a function of frequency. So you may have a curve, something like this. You might have impedance over here called Z, and then frequency, F. You may have something that goes like this, but it's going to average whatever the value is based on frequency. 20k hertz over here, and over here 20 hertz. And I don't know what this value is going to be. But anyway, this calculator is really helpful, and hopefully this will help you out. Hey guys, I'll talk a few minutes about charging this 5S Pelican 1200 do-it-yourself Bluetooth boombox. This is version 3. This system has 5 lithium batteries, 18650s in series. Each battery is nominally 4.2 volts DC fully charged. So 4.2 times 5 batteries will give you roughly about 21 volts. In this design here, I basically have 2 cells in parallel, so it's a total of 10. So charging, I was in the beginning for about a month using just a standard laptop charger that went into this 2.1 by 5.5 millimeter jack. Of course, the laptop only goes up to about 19.5 volts, but to get the full charge out of these lithium batteries, it needs to go up to about 21 volts. So in the meantime, it took about nearly 4 weeks to get this $15 21 volt 5S 2 amp charger. It's a constant voltage charger. And here it is, eBay. I don't have a link, but all you have to do is type in 21 volts 5S lithium battery charger. And this is what you'll get. It's a kind of a tiny little brick here. But let me plug it in real quick. So there is 20.4 volts on it right now. This is what the battery meter shows. Roughly 96%, 95%, just dropped the percent. So you can see as I plug it in over here, it should go up. Let's see, is it going up? Yep, it's going up right now. So I'm using a battery maintenance board, or not battery maintenance, a battery protection board, so it prevents overcharging and over discharging too. I think I've seen this as high as 21.4 volts, and that's okay. I think absolute value is about 4.25 volts per cell. So on the inside, I'll just disconnect this real quick. Just as a review, you can watch my other video on this boombox and see that pictures for the build. But on the inside, basically, I have 12 volts. I'm sorry, 21 volts coming in through here, It does go through a fuse, and this design is fused on the positive side of, let's see, is it really fused on the positive? Yeah, it is fused on the positive side. So with these particular cheap eBay protection boards, it's actually coming off of this lead over here. But you have to follow the schematic. Each of these eBay cheap boards, they generally seem to work pretty well. I only had one or two go bad on me. But you wire it up per schematic. In this case, all the batteries are pointing back, which is going to be positive. And each bank is in parallel one. So I think in this particular case, this is 1S. So this would be 3 to 3.7 volts. And then this would be 8.4. This would be 12.6, 16.8. And then this last pair will be 21 volts. Lastly, very quickly, I'm just going to draw a quick schematic of this actual boombox, Pelican 1200, version 3 in a 5S configuration. Just a couple notes. You'll notice that the Bluetooth light, which is the supposed to be blue on this one here, and then green power, I had a bit of noise coming in, and the noise actually happened to be from this green power light. So what I did was I put these two in parallel so that this is giving me Bluetooth indicator status. So right now it's blinking, so it's searching for Bluetooth. If it goes steady, it means it's connected. It also lets me know that the unit is on besides the, you know, the display on the battery capacity meter here. If I turn it off, it goes off, and turn it on, comes back on. So that's good enough for me to let me know that the unit's turned on here. Just give you a couple gotchas here. This board was purchased a couple years ago. This is one of the very first production boards. It's a JAB. It's a 30 watt per channel stereo with built-in Bluetooth 4.0. I think it's the JAB2 version. There's a JAB1, which is 50 watts per channel. There's a JAB2, 30 watts per channel. And then a JAB3 is 50 watts per channel. Anyway, in this case here, this one, when I did buy this, it did come with a stereo input jack. So this stereo input jack is right here. This is the source of the noise. Well, when it's plugged in, there's the jack there. But anyway, if it's plugged in, there's actually, it's pretty well known, you can go on YouTube and find out why the noise is coming in. But there's actually three wires that this one came with. The new ones come with four and tells you to cut off one of them to prevent the noise. And I believe someone explained it as that fourth wire being either switching on or off the Bluetooth or whatever. But anyway, I have it on all the time and that wire is cut. And what I'm trying to say is this connection here, which was for power, this was for Bluetooth, is going to parallel with these two LEDs. Well, whenever this one was connected, it was giving me a lot of noise, and it was very proximity sensitive. Even when I tried routing the wire somewhere else, it was still picking up a lot of noise. For some reason, when I built version 1 with the same board, I did not have that issue, so this might be just a first production anomaly. That's my guess, because I spent the whole day on and off during the day just trying to figure this out. So the cleanest way to have this on is just basically not to connect the power LED for this board. Last thing I'm going to go over, a real quick schematic of this thing, as I mentioned. Hey guys, Mo again here. So I'm going to start from scratch. You just have to forgive me. I'm just going to try to do this at the top of my head based on this one here. It should be a fairly simple design. So we'll start with the battery pack. I just draw one of the cells, actually each one. So this would be one of the batteries, positive here, negative. I actually have it backwards, but that's okay. I think you guys get the point. So basically this will go into your battery protection board. I guess I'll draw each one real quick. One more in the end here. So I'll call this reference 0 volts here. And what I'll do is I will connect these in series. That. And then on this end, you will have 21 volts. Between here and here, you have 3.7. Between the top of the second battery and the third, you'll have 8.4. And between the third and fourth, you have 12.6. And then between the fourth and fifth, you have 16.8. Assuming full charge battery is 4.2. Okay, this battery maintenance board will typically have a negative and a positive out. That'll be in for charging and out for charging. But then it'll also have a bunch of connections to tell you exactly where to connect it. So in this case here, the zero will probably go to the 0 point, and then in between the first and second battery at 4.2, this is going to get messy. Let's come up to the next one, and then the same way between the second and third for 8.4, because you need the monitor. You need to monitor 0, 4.2, 8.4, 12.6, and then 16.8, and finally 21 over here. That's a typical, I just call this a battery protection board, eBay. This is a 5S. And then from here, so this is your power supply. From here, I have a DC jack coming in. Center pin is typically positive, and then negative is on the side over here. What I typically do, I'll put a fuse in between the positive battery and then the fuse for the charging jack. This is the DC charging jack. Negative will be negative over here. Okay, so from here, I typically will put a switch in for the whole system. And this is going to go to all your loads. Negative will always go to, I'll just put it as ground here. Okay, so this is your power supply here. You have a fuse right here for protection. I'll use a 5 amp in this case here, typically. These batteries are typically, these ABL 18650s are typically about 2200 milliamps. Even though they're advertised for 3,000 milliamps, I'll typically put at least two of them in parallel, so you roughly get about 4,500 milliamps. So if there were ever a short in charging here or on your load, if you have a complete circuit, it'll basically open up this fuse. Everything will go through the fuse and open up, and then protect everything else from burning up or shorting out. Provided everything else is working. So this is your power supply here. And then now we go out to all your loads. You have an amplifier here. This is going to be the JAB2, 30 watts by 2. In this case here, this one has a volume control header. So that's pretty simple. It's just a pot. Volume. It'll have another header for a positive supply and negative. So from here, all I have to do is wire it up to positive and ground here to ground. And then speakers, you have right, left, positive, negative, and these will go out to your speakers. Remember, let's see, where's that drawing? Remember this drawing here with the amp? So right channel goes out in parallel to this passive crossover network with the speakers. You have your tweeter here, and then you have your woofer here. It does the same thing towards the left channel too. Oh, okay, so what else do we have? We also have your battery meter. Display here, and it's pretty simple. It just goes in positive and then negative. Let's see, anything else? And then you have your LEDs. That's pretty simple. You have your power LED, which I'm not using, but I'm using my Bluetooth LED. So here's the Bluetooth LED. They're both wired in series. Here's my switch right here for that guy there. And then my volume control knob should be that guy there. DC charging jack should be this guy here. All right, let's say you wanted to wire this up like my latest Pelican 1430 that has 2 amps and a subwoofer in it, and maybe a couple other items too. Oh yeah, it also has a 2.1 preamp board and also a BBE, and also a Bluetooth receiver. So if that's the case, this part here is essentially axed, but we still have the same power, right? So you have an amp, call this an amp. We'll call this the Bluetooth receiver 4.0. Oh, yeah, I forgot, in this case here, there's also a 3.5 millimeter stereo jack. That basically gets wired in parallel. Actually, it goes, there's a header for this guy here, but I'll show you how to wire it in parallel. So basically your Bluetooth will have power requirement, positive, negative. It'll be from supposedly 9 to 15 volts, but 17 volts is actually okay. But then you have a signal coming out. You have ground, right, left. And then we'll draw the 2.1 amp. It's a subwoofer preamp, actually, and in this case here, let's draw the this will be the 3.5 millimeter stereo jack. If you do the pinout, typically this will be ground. I believe this is right channel, and then the end of the tip is left. So these are basically going to go into the output of each of these guys here. So left to left, right to right, and then ground to ground. And then from here, this is the output. It's going to basically go into the input of the 2.1. You have ground, let's call this right, left, left to left, ground to ground, right to right. Draw the arrows telling you which way it's going. So now you have wireless signal that's receiving, coming from this Bluetooth receiver, is coming from your phone, your Samsung, iPhone, whatever, wirelessly. It also can come in with a 3.5 millimeter stereo jack, which is wired, physically wired in parallel with the Bluetooth. Signal's coming in through here, and then what you have is you have your out, right, ground, left for stereo, and then you have the same thing for the subwoofer. Let's say we'll call this ground, right, left, but this is summed. So technically, these two channels are together. We'll talk about this in a minute. And ground is ground, basically. So we'll just call this positive and negative for now. This will also have a power requirement, negative, positive. We can simply hook this up right now. It'll be switched. Remember, switched right here. Negative will go to negative. right here. So now we have two amps. We have the 100 watt, in this case by two, and then same thing here, or your mono amp, but in this case I'm only using one channel. So we'll have an input, again, ground, right, left. Simply hook these up, right to right, ground to ground, left to left. And then from here, you're gonna have, of course, this right here. You're gonna have a right channel, left channel, negative, positive, negative, positive. Goes out to your speaker network, crossover network, and then your speakers. So this would be the tweeters that you have over here with the woofers. And in this case with the 2.1, remember that the subwoofer control has three knobs on it. It has volume, it has subwoofer volume, and then, most importantly, the subwoofer crossover. So the subwoofer crossover will be a knob on here. It'll go from, I believe, 30 hertz to 300 hertz. So I have it crossed somewhere in between, maybe 100, 150 hertz, can't really tell. So anything above 150 hertz, let's say, is amplified by a 3-inch woofer or mid-range, and then this 3/4-inch tweeter over here. So this handles anywhere from 150 hertz up to, let's say, 20 kilohertz. And then now we have the same thing, right, ground, left. In this case, I think I'm only using the right channel. So this is all signal level here. This is all signal level. We're talking probably less than 1 volt here. So the sub output from the 2.1 preamp goes into right channel. Remember, these two, left and right, are summed. So it really doesn't matter which one, but I'm only using one channel here. So the ground will go over to ground here. So I'm not using this one here. And since this has positive, negative out, it's right, left, I'm only using this one here. This is going directly to the subwoofer. 5-inch, in this case, tang band. And then what about power for these guys here? Well, each one of these amps can handle up to 36 volts. I believe about 12 to 36 volts. So it just simply has a negative, positive, negative, positive. You can hook these guys up together if you want, but eventually they're going to be in parallel. And remember, this is our, we have our ground over here, and then we have our switched 21 volts over here. So all I have to do is hook those guys up. So positive will go all the way over. It's going to get a little messy right here. And the negative, well, I have to cut through all this stuff here. Oh, sorry about that. You guys get the idea. Should have went around without all these other half hoops. So we got power to this guy, which is good for 12 to 24 volts DC subwoofer amp. We're within the range of the power requirements for both amps here, because they're both the Shure 100 watt TDA7498 chipset amps. They can take up to 36 volts. But this Bluetooth, it can only take up to 17, so what am I doing here? So here's a positive negative. So negative is easy. We just connect it right here. Here's negative right here. But what I'm doing with this guy here is I'm actually tapping off of the 16.8 line right here. But there's a trick. So remember, I have the switch that works for this guy. I'm switching the positive side. But with this latest build, the Pelican 1430, I'm not switching it over here. So let's put this, let's get rid of this here. What I'm doing is, I'm switching ground. That's the trick. So there's the trick to this setup for that Pelican 1430, because I have one battery voltage meter that takes 24 volts. In this case here, I'd have one more battery. So there is a small difference here. I do have it coming up over here, negative, positive, and then this would be a 6S protection board. So you'd have 25.2 volts over here. So to answer this question here, where am I getting this 17 volts from? Well, I'm tapping it off the 16 point line, which is going to be between batteries 4 positive and 5 negative, which are in series here. Remember, I forgot to make that distinction there, but I think you guys get the point. If you have any questions, just let me know. So this is essentially the schematic for the Pelican 1430. If there's any errors in here that I've made, I do apologize in advance, but this is right off the top of my head. I just want to reiterate, I usually don't write anything down. I just seem to just wire everything by my head. When people ask me to draw a schematic for this and that, well, every one of my boom boxes is going to be slightly different, but most of the principles are still the same. You're going to have this power supply here. I typically use a switch on the positive side of the battery, but in this case it's negative because I wanted to have negative switched. That's common to all loads, even though the positive side was different for just the Bluetooth. I only wanted about 17 volts here, but the battery meter wanted 24 volts. The subwoofer 2.1 preamp crossover wanted 24 volts, and then the pair of amps also wanted 24 volts too. Anyway, I hope this helps. And if you have any questions, I try to do my best to get back to them as soon as I can. Just to let you know, I just travel a lot every week. I'll be out for the next 3 weeks, Monday through Friday, for my real job. So keep in mind, this is just a hobby. Just want to share a few things, some of my unique builds that I've done with my hobby here, and just encourage you guys to give it a try too. I know sometimes it gets a little bit expensive, but this is all coming out of my pocket. I don't have any sponsors, affiliates yet, but I'm thinking about possibly going down that road so I can bring this out to you guys. Have a great night. Bye.